And I did search there along with one other person, so us two rebrand the search product there. And then now I work at a startup called Cask, and we are a big data startup, and we want to make it easy for people to write applications that process data in parallel. And so like these types of machine learning things are easier for people to do. So Yahoo, I did recommendation systems. So this is the front page of Yahoo. And one of the things my team was responsible for was deciding which of these articles we would show to people when they visit the front page. And so how that works in general is we divide people into buckets. 1% of the time, by random, you would get random stories here. And then we would collect that data in real time, train a model on it, and use that to rank the stories for everyone else. So this is one of the things I was responsible for. At Box, I was worked on search. So how do you search for your files? Pretty standard search solution there. And this is some architecture diagram of what we do at Cask in the big data space. I can talk about that more if you're interested, but for the purpose of this talk, we're going to focus on machine learning here. So why is learning from data important? So I'll talk through some examples. So one of the first things people did in this space was product recommendations, right? So this is from Amazon, some ugly t-shirts. And something like this is pretty clear to see. It helps drive sales. It helps the customer find what they're looking for. And it helps improve your revenue and your profitability. Google, the reason why they're so rich is ad targeting and search. And so how they make money is companies decide they want to advertise on Google, and they're able to match your product with search key terms very effectively. And that's how they make all their money, that's why people advertise on Google. So examples of a search I did on Swift was, these are all ads. So also things that larger companies, like retail companies have been doing for a long time is they'll put something on sale and then they know what you tend to buy with that item. And so say you buy milk and cookies a lot. If cookies are pretty high, expensive, then they might decide to put milk on sale for a little bit, knowing that you'll buy both at the same time and then drive up how much they make. And so these are just some examples. They're not too recent. And you can tell that learning from data has been around for a long time. It's not just self-driving cars, it's not just voice recognition, not this kind of fancy sci-fi stuff, but it's been a lot of different practical applications. Okay, so here, I'll give an overview of some of the different types of problems that you can solve with machine learning, and kind of very high-level overviews of how they work. There'll be some math here. I'm going to ask some questions for answers. But one sentence, machine learning, almost all of these approaches boil down to maximizing a function or minimizing a function. So who remembers from math how do you find the maximum?
Derivative?
Zero? Take derivative? Yeah, take derivative and set to zero, right? You get a t-shirt.
Wow.
And that's actually what most of these algorithms boil down to, is there's some mathematical model, some way to represent different points in your training data, and then you're solving for some equation. And it's usually you have a bunch of variables, take a derivative, you set it to zero. And how you represent your data, there's this term called features. And a feature is something that describes your data. So for example, if you have a bunch of housing prices, you might describe a house by how much it costs, the number of bedrooms it has, the number of bathrooms, how old it is, how big it is. And all of these are what we call features of your data. And so for example here, we represent the this house that costs $1,000 is a feature of these four vectors, as a vector of these four features. Right? A vector just being some point in space. And so in this case, four-dimensional space. And then there's some model, some mathematical function that usually you use to generate some prediction based on these feature vectors. So in this case, all these red dots would be your training points, right? They'd be your feature vectors. And then this line would be your data model that predicts some value based on the data that you have. So at a very high level, this is kind of what all machine learning algorithms look like. So the classic example of machine learning and classification is naive Bayes and applied to email spam classification. And so classification is one general type of problem that you can use machine learning to solve. And this is, given some item, what class is it in? Right? So given an email, is it spam, is it not spam? Given a text document, a news article, is it a sports article, is it a finance article, is it a business article? Given some text on a page, some image, is it a number, is it which letter of the alphabet, is it things like that. And this is the simplest of them, and just to give you an overview of how it works, it's based on Bayes' rule, and this is kind of a rule that you'll find in statistics that a lot of these learning algorithms are based off of. And why it's important is this probability of A given B is usually pretty hard to predict, hard to measure itself. But the probability of B given A is easy to measure. And that's the importance of this. And in this particular example, the probability that something is spam, given the email contents, that's harder to measure directly. But the probability that the content is spam is easier to measure. So to give a concrete example, right? Let's say I have one feature, and that's where the word free appears in my email subject. And so here I say the probability that my email is spam, given the fact that I've seen the word free, is equal to the probability that free is in the email, given it's a spam email, times the probability that email is spam in general, divided by the probability that I see the word free. And so when I'm deciding whether or not email is spam or not, I don't actually care about the bottom number, right, because they're the same for both. What I'm going to do is calculate both of these. Whatever is higher, that's what I'm going to choose, whether this email is spam or not. And then these probabilities are easy to calculate, right? Probability of spam is you take some training data that you have, you've already labeled it as spam or not, and you just count. How many are spam? How many emails do I have? Probability that spam is just, you do a simple division. Same down here, probability that free, given spam is just the number of spam emails with free divided by the number of total spam emails, right? And so something like this, it's very easy to calculate because you're just counting and dividing. And then the reason naive is in this word, this phrase, is because we're making a naive assumption here, where we say, so normally you have many, many features, right? You have a feature for each word, for example, that can possibly show up in an email. So you say, like, what's the probability that my email is spam given it has the words free and tacos in it, right? And the naive assumption I'm making is the fact that free and tacos are independent, so I can just separate them out down there and just multiply. And so what something like this ends up looking like is you just count in your emails how many times each word appears, and then you just do divisions. It's very simple. And so something like this was, I think, one of the first papers written on classification. Very simple things, and something that you might do yourself if you were just thinking of a way to do it. So some more complicated ones and things you might want to use today based off the shelf. types of classification models. It's called a support vector machine, SVM. And how it works is it tries, so you have data points, and it tries to find a line that separates your data points. Though in actuality, it's not really a line, it's a hyperplane, because you've got like thousands of dimensions in your data, not just two. And how it works is it tries to maximize the distance between your line and the points on either side of it. And so there's your maximization function, and then you do some math, and that's what the model is. And so in all of these approaches, you have training data, which is data that's usually somebody has manually gone through and labeled to say, what is this, this or this or this or this. So some other class of problems, recommendations. So like if you're Netflix, right, and you want to say, you've seen this movie, these are some other movies you might be interested in. One of the common approaches is called collaborative filtering. And this is where you represent each user as a vector of the products in your space. And so for the Netflix example, you would say, for me, I've watched these movies, and I have these movies in my Netflix library. And so I'm a big vector of zeros and ones. And so is everyone else. And based on this, I can find users that are most similar to me. And the way I do that is my signs, my symbols did not appear correctly. But it's just math, it's geometry. You measure the angle between these two vectors, and the smaller that angle is, the more similar you are. And you can do that just by doing a dot product, which is multiplications and additions, right? So pretty simple stuff. And then once you find the most similar users, you can look at what they've viewed and that I haven't viewed, and then you can do recommendations based on that. So another simple type of model here is an odds ratio. And so in this box here, we'll see, so we'll take the milk and cookies example again, and say I want to recommend items to someone who I know has milk in their shopping cart. Right? What should you buy if you're buying milk? So for this model, I just need to count a few things. I need to count the number of people who bought both, who've bought just one of them, and who've bought neither of them. And that's enough for me to calculate this number. And then what I'll be doing is finding the highest number of items with the highest score based on this and recommending those. And so how this works, if you look at this top part, probability that someone buys cookies and milk together, given that they're buying milk, right? So this is assuming I'm a user, I bought milk, what's the probability that I'll also buy cookies, right? So that's the top. Does anyone have any idea why the top is usually not all that we rank by? So this, in words, would be people who bought milk also, number of people who bought milk also bought cookies. Anyone have a guess why that usually is not enough? Okay. Usually why we don't just use this is because, let's say, everyone bought cookies. No matter what, cookies would always show up at the top thing. And they're not necessarily most relevant to milk. They're just very popular. So that's why the bottom part is there, to kind of offset that effect, most popular. And so these are kind of common things that you can do yourself, just by counting. We have another type of problems. We have things like regression. And so this you might have learned about in statistics, right? You have a bunch of data points, and you want to find a line. And you're assuming there's a line that models the value that you're predicting. And here, all you're doing is you're measuring the distance from each point to the line, and you're trying to minimize that. So again, just minimizing something. There's another type of regression called logistic. And this you're assuming that your data follows this curve, which is called the logistic. And this you can also use for classification, right? If you look at it, it looks a lot like a step function. But you can also use it for predicting values.
Okay. So now that I've bored you with some of the math, I can talk about some practical advice. So really the most important thing that is to collect as much data as you can. So I work in the big data space, and the reason big data is very big is most of the time companies don't know why and how they're going to use their data. They're just collecting as much as they can and figuring out much later how they're going to get value from it. And a lot of times you don't know, you know, what questions to ask about your data. You don't know how you can use it until you actually have it and you've looked at it and you've examined it and you've analyzed it. So there's lots of ways to collect it. The most simplest, you just, you know, log it in files. Right? You have a web server somewhere, you're logging all the requests people are making, you're logging when certain things happen. Just keep those around somehow. So you can keep them on your server, you can put them in the cloud, in S3, you can do a lot of different things. Right? Yeah, you can put them as data in databases, traditional relational databases, you can put them in other non-traditional ones, unstructured ones, you can put them in the cloud in different databases as well. And what we see a lot in the industry in Silicon Valley now is people are just publishing all their events to different messaging systems. Real-time messaging systems, and then they're reading those in real time and then putting them into some more persistent storage after doing some like simple processing checks. And for that, you can use technologies like Kafka, which is built from LinkedIn. LinkedIn uses that for all their messaging. RabbitMQ is another open source free tool. But basically, the point here is collect as much as you can, and then you can figure out how to use it later. You don't have to be high-tech to do this, even if you're like, you know, just some grocery store, you can log in on pen and paper, right? And then some things for how to store it. So really, you just want to store it someplace where you can query it easily. So like spreadsheets, for example, is a very simple place to put your data. It might be manual work, understand it a little better. Various databases, there's various visualization tools that help you examine it. These are some open source free ones. And really, this is not anything different than you know, stuff that's been around for a long time. And so this, for how you can process it, so machine learning is just statistics. There's nothing to be scared of there. Even if you don't understand the math, even if you don't understand how anything works, usually what happens is someone who does writes code and then open sources it and everyone can use it, right? And for a lot of these things, you can just put in a little bit of effort and you'll get most of the gains. And so something that you do in a couple days might take you 80% of the way there, and then you could spend another year trying to do the next 20%. And actually, what happens most of the time for people who are data scientists is that they're not doing any fancy like algorithm work. They're not coming up with new approaches to anything. All they're doing is they're looking at data, they're cleaning it up. Like, these columns are empty when they shouldn't be, but you filter them. And they're coming up with new features. Just saying, like, maybe instead of just number of bedrooms for a house, I can look at, you know, the color of the walls. And so data scientists actually aren't doing, most of the time, anything fancy. They're doing very simple things. Things that you can do yourself. So when I was at Yahoo, the best performing model was basically, you just ranked stories by what was most popular in different user segments. So this is not anything fancy. We had a bunch of PhDs in artificial intelligence, and that's basically what they do. And something simple, just you looking at things yourself, asking questions about what you've collected, and making very simple decisions is better than nothing. In the Valley, a lot of times, like companies like Apple, when you say something like, we should do this, you have to have some data backing you up, otherwise no one will listen to you. And so it doesn't even have to be for complicated learning algorithms, just when you make decisions, you should be looking at data, you should be trying to back up what your assumptions are by